Hello, Faithway. Good evening. I pray that you're all doing well, keeping safe. I know it's been good weather the past few days, so hope many of you have took advantage of that. I'm going to bring a small devotional today before the prayer meeting. Just looking forward to sharing from Zechariah, verse 10 of chapter 12. I believe this is really encouraging verse for us in the assurance that we have of God's active work in our faith, and his active work out of love to bring us to him. And so, as I was reading this in my devotions a couple days ago, I thought that I would share with you today. So, if you join with me to Zechariah chapter 12, verse 10, we'll get started here. It says in verse 10, "Then I will pour out a spirit of grace and prayer on the house of David and the residents of Jerusalem. And they will look at me, whom they pierced. They will mourn for him as one mourns for an only child, and weep bitterly for him as one weeps for a firstborn." Now, this verse in context has a lot of things going on, but there's a real reality that this applies to our situation today. And in fact, this verse is even quoted in the New Testament in John 19, verse 37, right after Jesus is pierced by soldiers while he's on the cross. And they quote this verse as a prophecy of this time when Jesus is pierced for our transgressions. And it quotes the part of verse 10 that says, "And they will look at me whom they pierced." Now, before getting into that particular part of this verse, I think it's important to start off with the first sentence here, as it's really a reality that we can hold true to today. It says, "Then I will pour out a spirit of grace and prayer on the house of David and the residents of Jerusalem." This is the CSB that I'm reading from, but in the ESV, it says, "Then I will pour out a spirit of grace and pleas of mercy." Now, prayer and pleas of mercy are similar in a sense that when we cry out to God, it truly is a prayer or a plea for mercy. And so when he says, "I'll pour out a spirit," this is talking about God's spirit. This is talking about the Spirit of God, which New Testament believers now know to be the Holy Spirit of God. And so what we can learn here is really something that we need to take into our devotion. It's a confidence that we can have that this spirit is both the spirit that enlightens the work of God's gospel. It is the spirit that will pour out grace onto us to enlighten us to the truth of the gospel. And this spirit will not only just show us the understanding of what Jesus's death on the cross has done for us, but it will also give us the pleas of mercy, give us the prayers that we need to come to faith in him. So this is an amazing reality. We know that we are saved by grace through faith, not by good works, so no man can boast. And yet, this beautiful reality of that case is that it's not just about the fact that we will not boast in ourselves, but that there's a real and true intimate and loving way in which God reaches us, that his spirit not only gives us the understanding of this grace, but even gives us the cries, gives us the pleas to him for forgiveness. So the first thing that I'm just so encouraged by in this verse is that when we come to God, it truly is an act of God working through us to come to himself. It is really God that both shows us the faith, shows us the reality of God's work through Christ, and then even gives us our faith in giving us those pleas for mercy to come to his throne of grace. We see and later on in this sentence here at verse 10, "And they will look at me whom they pierced." And as I said already, that John 19, verse 37 quotes this reality. And so when we think about the Spirit's intercession or work in giving us an understanding of the grace of God and in giving us pleas for mercy, it is that that grace and that plea of mercy that is centered on him whom we have pierced. It is Jesus Christ and his death and resurrection that the Spirit enlightens us to. It is the Spirit that shows us the reality of what Christ has done on the cross and what it means for us as believers. It's the Spirit that shows us the reality that we are dead in our sin and that God can make us alive together in Christ Jesus. It is that Spirit that gives us these cries to God that we come to him for forgiveness, and that through Christ's death, his piercing on the cross, and his resurrection 3 days later, we can have confidence and assurance that we will be numbered as one of his elect and will be seated with him in heaven and glory. And the third part, which I find so encouraging as well, is the work of repentance in our hearts. Now, Spurgeon tells us that repentance is not the prerequisite of faith, but actually the consequence of a faith in Jesus Christ. And so we see in Zechariah 12, verse 10, that the Spirit enlightens the grace of Jesus' piercing on the cross. It gives us the pleas for mercy. And then once we have looked at Jesus, at the one at whom we've pierced, that is when we mourn. That is when we mourn for our sin. It says they will mourn for Christ as one mourns for an only child, and weep bitterly for Christ as one weeps for a firstborn. And I've added Christ in there because this truly is, as we see in John 19, verse 37, pointing to Christ. And so this mourning, this repentive heart comes only after a true faith in Christ is given to us by the Spirit. Again, as Spurgeon said, we so often think that a conviction must come of sin before we have faith in Christ. And there's a reality to the fact that the gospel is not just about God's love, but about his judgment on sin and Satan. And so there's a reality that when we evangelize, there's a reality that when we look to our life, that we must recognize the weight of our sin and the separation that it causes between us and God. And yet, at the same time, we must recognize that it is not our own heart that realizes that sin is wrong and that we hate sin, but it's actually God who provides us a faith to see the weight of our sin and then causes us to repent of it, causes us to have a softened heart that will receive the message of Jesus and then repent of our sins. And so this reality that God is at work in our faith is true, and we see it in Zechariah 12, verse 10. We see it in the work of even understanding what Jesus has done. We see it in the work of providing us the pleas for mercy. We see it in the work of his Son providing the way on the cross. Through the Spirit and the Son, God's will that we would turn away from our sins is enacted, that it is ultimately the Spirit and the Son that fulfill the will of the Father in us, that we would be more sanctified and holy in relationship with our Father, that we would know Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord, and that our repented hearts would come out of a faith in Jesus Christ given to us by the Spirit. That the Trinity is working so intimately and actively in our faith that we have no need for doubt, no need for uncertainty, that we can have full assurance that our faith has been sealed not by our own doing, but ultimately by God's great work through us in his Trinitarian love. So I hope this has been an encouragement before we go into our prayer, that we would acknowledge that God truly is behind our faith, that he's truly the one that gives us our pleas for mercy, gives us the way to repentance, and provides us with that repentance. So this has been a great encouragement for me, and I just pray that it be for you as well. All right, bye-bye.